And I was the only one down there, Miss Cassidy. And so the fire department went down there, I ended up all myself reading his book. There was one fire department member, he was sleeping. He kept all the coffee cups, pocket number, and the new bill was spilled on it. He came out there and thought we capsized.
He thought it was all over with, he thought he was finished.
I laughed at him real boriously, but he was a big guy. Mild.
All right, Bill, well, let's get the dry administrative part out of the way. So today we're here to interview Mr. Sid. So Bill, would you spell and give your full name?
My full name is William Preston Sid. Last name spelled S-E-I-D.
All right, very good. Today's interviewers are John Goss, director of the Wyoming Military Museums, and
Doug Cubison, curator.
And today is August 7th, 2014, and we're in the multi-purpose room of the Wyoming Veterans Memorial Museum, located on the site of the historic Casper Army Air Base. And so today Bill's going to tell his story in the format of the Veterans History Project for the Library of Congress. And so, Bill, we're going to just kick it off, and you know, what we'd like to hear is a little bit about, you know, what you did before the war, where you were from, you know, and then and how you got into the war. So if we see you trying to think too hard about it, we'll throw a couple of prodding questions in there to jar you loose. But anyhow, let's go ahead and begin. So where were you from?
Okay, I was born and raised mainly in Sheridan, Wyoming. Born on August 7th, 1931. And I joined the Navy about 2 weeks before the Korean War started. At the time, I lived in Worland, Wyoming. And after all the papers filled out, the test taken, they sent me up to Helena, Montana. And from there, I took more tests and then physical, and I was sworn up there on the 9th of June of 1950. And when they put me on a train to go over the hills to Butte, and we swapped trains. There's one more guy with me going in. I can't remember his last name. I remember his first name was Joe. He was from Montana. And we went Beauty got on the train, and was in a Pullman car. We had upper berths, and our destination was San Diego, California, for boot camp, or as you majors like to term it, basic training. And it took 2 days at the time. 2 days to get 60 people there to make up a company in boot camp. And 2 weeks later, or about that, the Korean War started, and I was making up 4 or 5 companies a day. And they cut our boot camp training from 16 weeks down to 12, because they needed people to get out to the fleet. So after they got out of boot camp, I went to electrician mate school, and after 2 weeks there, they sent me over, same building though, but they sent me to the IC, Interior Communications Electrician School, which is in the same building as the electrician mate school. And that school was about 16 weeks long. And after that, I was assigned to my first ship, the USS Brown, DD-546. It had just been recommissioned in Long Beach, California. And the crew when I went aboard was about 90% reserves. And about 90% of those reserves were World War II veterans. And to show you how it was, in the electrical gang, that includes the electrician mates and the IC electricians, there were 13 people, and it was all reserves but myself and another IC striker who was fireman apprentices, which means I can't fix anything, and one first-class electrician mate. We were the only three regulars in the gang.
In the whole electrical gang?
In the whole electrical gang. And went through the training there, and we left in February of 51 to go to Korea. And we had a stopover in Honolulu for some more training there. And then went on, and we stopped at Midway Island to refuel, and then up to Sasebo, Japan. And we was there a couple of weeks, took on fuel and supplies, and they sent us up to around Korea, which was with Task Force 77 to start with. That's a carrier. They usually had two carriers there, and there may be 13, 14 destroyers for escorts, and sometimes there'd be a battleship there or a cruiser or two. And we operated with them. We usually go out for, spend 2 weeks online, go back to Japan for upgrade or upkeep on the ship, and then back out for 2 weeks or three. I forget now which one it was. It's been a while. But on our first trip over, one morning, we woke up. I'd had a 4-day watch in the morning, and somebody said the walk just hit a mine. The walk was in our division. There'd be four destroyers in a division. The USS Walk that hit a mine killed 27 guys. It went off in a berthing compartment. Mm-hmm. And I knew some of the guys on there for boot camp and schools and just hanging out around San Diego with them. And that was out out at sea, probably 10 miles, 20 miles from the coast of Korea. And then they sent them off to be repaired, you know. And we went into Wonsan Harbor to bombard and blockade, which was one of the longest blockades that the Navy had ever put in. And they would leave us in. They had a combat pay they'd pay them. If we was under fire for 5 days, we'd get $50 more a month. Well, they leave us in 4 days and then send us out on the fifth day to take on supplies.
Sounds like the military.
It's hard to remember all the stuff that went on, you know, in chronicle order.
Oh, sure, yeah.
This comes to my mind.
Now, how many guys were typically on the destroyer?
About 320.
Okay.
About 320. And when I was on there, I started out, this other IC fireman apprentice with me. He went to the, we drew cards to see who would go down to the engine room and work on electric switchboards and one would go to the IC space. Well, I lost, but in a way I won because I went to the engine room to be on the switchboard. So I learned a lot right there about how the machine, the engine rooms worked and how the big switchboards worked. And I spent 3 months there, and then we had to draw cards again to see who went on mess cooking. That's like KP, and it lasts 3 months. Well, we drew cards. I did win on that because I didn't get it. So then I went up to the IC room, and the bombarded. They shoot at us, we shoot back, you know, how they play the game. And what was kind of funny, I thought, was there'd be a couple of destroyers in there, and maybe a cruiser, and sometimes there'd be some of the Allied ships in there with us. But in the afternoon, about 3 o'clock, we started making a circle. And we'd go round and round. And I forget what they call it, war dance or something like that. You know, how they figure out these little names for this stuff. And when one went as close to the beach, you'd shoot and you'd go on around. Well, South Koreans had a little boat in there. They had a 40-millimeter gun on it. And they'd get in line to get around it. They lost some 40-millimeter bullets over there. And that we were just lucky that the North Koreans at the time was poor shots. Because there'd be splashes all around, and then they wised up. So they started firing airburst over us, just kind of shrapnel on the ship. And myself and another guy was walking up the deck one day, and they started shooting at us, and the airburst going off, and the shrapnel coming down. And so we ducked in under, up above, there was a 40-millimeter gun up there, and a little passageway underneath there, and some 20-millimeters over here. But we jumped behind this box for protection, and we're sitting there talking and nervous giggling going on. And then one of us realized, hey, we're hiding behind a 20-millimeter ready box. Had a few hundred rounds of ammunition in it. So we jumped up and ran back and got down safely. And, oh boy. At the time, my battle station was on a damage control party, which also manned the 20 millimeters. And after a while, they made me a gunner on one of the 20 millimeters, twin 20s. We'd have two loaders and a gunner, and I was the gunner. And with the guns at that time, it was easier to fire following the tracers than was using the sights I had on them, because the sights was on a box, and you get the two circles lined up. But the trouble was, when you went like this, they wouldn't swing around the right way. So it's easier to follow the tracers. And this friend of mine, name was Bill Hayden, he was on the one next to us, next to mine. And he was good. He was good on that. And during practicing, they fly planes over us, dragging a sleeve. And one time they put the Brown up at the head of the line. We'd be in a straight line going up. And we was the first ones in line. We shot down two or three sleeves, so they told us just to go to the back of the line and just follow along then, because we passed. which was rare for the Brown. And the one time I've told you about this, our Allied ship in Wonsan Harbor, they had a cruiser and they called frigates in there with us. And we had orders. We would go into Wonsan, we'd just drop the anchor and sit there and shoot. Uh-huh. And we were being shot at and we couldn't get our anchor up. Well, they had strict orders, don't slip the anchor, because we were losing too many anchors and they cost a couple dollars.
Uh-huh.
So their gun was bigger than our 5-inch guns. They had a longer range. You could see them up on the hill, you could see the flash. And then just down there, wait to see where it's going to land. Well, the Allied ships took off and left us there. And So here they are shooting at us, and we're shooting back, but we're not reaching where their guns are that are shooting at us. So we called for help, and they sent in the USS Helena. And they had 8-inch guns on, which made a big difference. And they just took a few rounds from them, and those other guns shut down. They weren't shooting at us anymore. And we got our ammo up and got us safely out of there. And that, with that Navy, that's why I have no respect for that Navy.
Yeah.
At all. Trying to think of things that happened.
Do you remember the names of the ships that, that left you there high and dry, or?
No.
Okay.
I didn't know them in the first place. I just know what country they're from, and I'm not going to say it right now. I've told you before in our private conversations. And while I was under Brown, we rode out some typhoons. And one was in transit, and I had a watch in the IC space, and we was taking some heavy rolls, and I had myself wedged in between the stable element and the fire control computer, and I was reading the Kane Mutiny, and there was a report about the typhoon. Well, we kept our coffee cups in a bucket of water, real sanitary.
Yeah.
And the bucket broke loose and spilled, and there was a fire controlman sleeping there, down there that day, because he couldn't sleep in his bunk. And the water spilled on him, and he came up, he thought we'd capsized. And I wanted to laugh, but he was too big to laugh at. And that was one of the funny things that happened. Another time, we was out there and it was a bad storm, and they sent in a bunch of photographers from Tokyo. There was going to be an invasion. So we was going to go in and bombard, they was going to send these photographers in. They came out on a carrier, and the carrier transferred over to us. And they brought all their cameras and stuff down the IC and plotting room. And they had their cameras all out there in the cases and all. And we headed in towards the beach, and it was rough. And we was going flank speed against the waves. And it was up and down, and up and down, and plowed through it, and sometimes more down than it was up, I think. But we were sitting there, eating sour cream and crackers, and drinking this purple drink we had. We had a private name for it, I can't say it here. But we were doing that, and all those photographers was in there, a bunch of them. And they were throwing up their hats, their camera cases, and everything else. They were sick. And that was kind of funny, really. But we wasn't eating the sardines and crackers to make them sick and watch and see them, because we wanted to eat them.
Yeah. Now, how did you take to sea life on your first cruise? Was it, did you take right to it, or did you have some struggles?
Well, the first time I went to sea was training in San Diego, right after I'd gone aboard. And I was in the engine room. The after engine room was the after switchboard. And I was getting a little woozy. So I went up, I had a puke, so I went up topside. Trouble is, I was facing the wind. I learned right then, you don't do that. When I came down, they was all laughing at me. There's all these World War II veterans laughing, and laughing at the little kid. And, I got seasick a couple more times, but never anything lasted long. What I do know is bad seasickness. Somebody could put a 45 in your head and they tell you, if you're not going to get out, I'm going to shoot you. Go ahead. So I'll feel better. But I wrote it out pretty good.
Now, What was the name of your, the captain of the ship?
At the time, it was Captain Denfield.
Denfield.
And he'd, I found out, well, at the time it didn't make much sense to him, but he'd been an engineer on a submarine.
Oh.
So that didn't really impress me until later years in my career. And he was a real nice guy. And then we had some other, I can't remember their names. I remember Denfield because of that. And after I left the Brown, went to the minesweep, he was a full captain. He was in charge of the sweeps in San Diego, or in Long Beach.
Oh, be darned. So you worked for him twice, essentially.
Yeah.
Oh, be darned.
Yeah.
Oh, be darned. Now, Bill, before we get too far, I was going to ask you, did the Brown pick up and drop off troops on shore? I think I remember a story you told us about picking up forward observers or something
we
like
would,
that.
There were some forward observers, there's Army, and we picked them up, and they'd had no hot meals or showers or anything for a long time. And they came aboard, and they could take a shower. When we took a shower, we didn't get wet, soaked down, rinse off and go. Maybe use a gallon of water. But they could get in and let it run all they wanted to, which I admired those people. I was pretty young then. And they got their clothes all washed on their board. They did that for a long. Then we gave them some sea rations or whatever and sent them back. And another time was in Wonsan. This reminded me of that. We was in Wonsan, and they had an island out there with some British Marines on it. And they was out getting supplies and stuff from us. We was in Wonsan Harbor. They came over to us to get some supplies and stuff. We was giving food and fresh water and stuff like that to take back. And just while we was doing that, loading them up, they had a LSM or one of those last small landing crafts. And they started shooting at us, and they was coming pretty close. So they took off this way, we took off this way. Trouble was, they forgot to take the line off. So we ripped the tail end of the boat off. But they made it in. But one of their men he didn't get off the boat onto their boat. He was trapped with us. We was on the main deck and shooting at him. And number three gun mount, 5-inch gun mount, was on the O1 level. You got the main deck, and you got the O1 level right above that. And they was firing out there. And we said, we better move, because when they fired, the hot shell would take it and throw it out. And it cracked down onto the main deck, the empty shell. Well, he didn't know this Marine. Hit him in the forehead, split his forehead open, he'd land there knocked out and bleeding. We looked at us, well, guess somebody better call the corpsman. So they called the corpsman, they came up, took care of him, and he got back to him the next day, I think. He just had a cut head and a headache.
Probably still does.
That's serious. It wasn't funny at the time, but it was sounds kind of funny now.
What's that combat humor? You got to laugh at things like that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I was working on the underwater log under Brown one time, and somebody was pounding on the hull. I thought, what the hell are they doing up there pounding on the hull? We're here in Wonsan, they shoot at us once in a while. So I looked up to see who was over the side pounding, chipping paint or whatever. It was splashes from their shells just hitting right close.
Oh.
And it's splashing. And go off, it sounded like somebody was pounding on the bulkhead, on the hull of the ship. Well, I went back down, which wasn't much protecting, it was only about so thick.
Mm-hmm.
And the destroyers, they're just made for go quick and protect the aircraft carriers.
Well, there was another story that I remember that you used to tell. And you actually got to work on a 5-inch gun or a 5-inch fire control.
I was working on the phone system.
On the phone system.
Number 5 gun mount.
Uh huh.
and they fired number four gun mount right over it.
Mm-hmm.
And in those gun mounts, they kept ready shells up there, just in case, you know. Well, I was in there working, and I was all by myself, and they fired, and the concussion threw the one of the shells out to land on. I was out there. I never got out of one of those things fast in all my life, because I just knew it was going to blow up, and I was going to blow up with it. And I ran up the deck, and there was a gunner's man. They told me that. He just kind of giggled and went back there and picked up, put it back where it belongs.
And then there was another time you got to actually pull the trigger on 5 inches, right?
Well, that was from the fire control room.
Oh, the fire control room, that's right.
Yeah, we had, there was a bunch of North Korean soldiers going down the beach. And the fire control gang at the time, they, for some reason, they had a shortage of people. So they was in the fire control, or IC and plotting room, so that's where I was anyway. So I'd go over and help them. And they said there was 20 people. And we fired one round to let the back of them, one in front of them, and the third one right in the middle of them. That's when I was firing that. And the biggest, the most ships I saw when I was over there in one little group, a small group, there was four carriers, four cruisers, two battleships, and 23 destroyers. So we headed all, well, went way up north, and turned around and came down. And on the way back down, they launched all the planes off the carriers. They went in and flew and made it a bomb, and we just kept going south. So they went in this way and then back out to the ships and landed. And I think that the Million Bridge of Tokoreen was part of that, taken from that. You know, probably not, but it just seemed familiar to me.
Sure.
Sure. Strange things happen.
Yeah, everybody's role is unique in those kind of things. So.
Yeah.
Before we get too far, I want to go way back to the beginning.
Okay.
And before you joined the Navy, I remember you saying that you did a stint in the Wyoming National Guard. I think that's that's an interesting thing. Yeah. How did that go, and when did you join that?
I was a junior in high school.
Oh.
When I joined the National Guard in Sheridan. And I went to one summer camp with them from Sheridan. And at the end of that summer, we went from Sheridan to Worland, Wyoming. That's where I finished my high school. And I transferred to that. It was the same outfit, different, what do you call them?
Battery.
Different battery. Because Sheridan was a headquarters battery, and I think Worland was a
C battery or something?
I think it was C
battery.
Or Charlie in the big boys' terms.
300
field artillery.
That's right.
And that's where I was when I joined the Navy. I had to get discharged from there before I could go into the Navy.
Right.
If I had waited 2 weeks, I'd have gone to Korea with the National Guard. Because it was the first outfit to be called in with 300th Armored Field Artillery.
That's right, yeah.
And then they got quite highly decorated outfit.
They did.
They're pretty popular. Especially with the Marines.
Yes.
That's the funny thing about it.
You just never know who you're going to work for when you're there.
Yeah. And when I was on the ground, beside Korea, we, in the Navy, I think a lot of people in the other services, we might be in up around Korea, and in 2 weeks, be down around the Philippines, or however long it would take us to get there. Then we went down the one time, that's where I got my China service ribbon, and went down to patrol in the, Taiwan Straits, then we call it Formosa Straits.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I got that, which the islands of Kamoi and Matsu.
Okay.
The communists had come out and take those over. And so we patrol them to keep them. They have two destroyers out there going back and forth. It was quite boring, really. And it was rough the whole time. And people wouldn't get sick, but they just wore out.
Yeah,
because you couldn't sleep.
Just rough water. I'll be darned. And were they doing that before Korea and after Korea? Was that just a long time Cold War thing?
This was during Korea when I was
okay.
When I was there, because we made our third deployment over there, and we're sitting in. We got to Yokosuka, Japan. I was sitting there. We were supposed to leave the next day to go to up to Korea. And that's when they signed the ceasefire. So we got another week or two in port.
Well, that's nice.
And the day they signed it, there in Yokosuka, they had a really neat fireworks display up that night. It was really something.
I bet.
And I went through two or three yard periods on the brand, and they made some major changes in it. And I finished up my first enlistment on the brand. And I got discharged. I went out, and I stayed out a year. And I thought, well, at the time in 1954, jobs wasn't really quite available.
Did you come back to Wyoming during that time?
I came back to Wyoming. Went back to Worland. Got married, had a baby, and I got tired of messing around with do nothing jobs. I thought, I'm going to go back in, because I really couldn't figure out why I got out in the first place, because I liked it. I think it was peer pressure, you know, from the people that didn't like it, and I went along with them, but I did like it. So I went back in, and when I went in, I got put on the USS Fortify, a minesweeper. It was MSO 446, which was on the Brown DD 546, and the minesweeper for the Fortify, MSO 446.
No, they don't. Easy to remember.
Yeah. And it was a completely different type of Navy on the minesweeper. 60 some people on board.
Small crew.
It was made out of wood, but the living conditions on there was better because you had wood floors.
Oh, really?
Wood bulkheads, and the hull was about that thick of all wood, and it was all diesel powered. But I enjoyed my time on there. The worst thing I had about it was so slow. The only thing we could outrun was LSTs. And that was a struggle sometimes. There was so-called peacetime. The Cold War was going on, but that had been going on for a long time. And I learned a lot on there. It was a different Navy, bought minesweeper and all. Like the motto of the minesweepers at the time, and guess, well, that met this one World War II veteran. He'd been on minesweepers then, and the motto was then, when they started, where the fleet goes, we've been.
Right.
Which makes sense. But I liked it on the Fortify, except for the speed being so slow. I made one Westpac trip on the Fortify. We get a, going through a typhoon on that. We go up on deck, you look over, watch the boards fly off the side of the ship. That was a little exciting.
I can imagine. Now, you were still an ICman on the Fortify, right?
Yeah.
How big was the electric gang on that?
4 or 5.
Oh, bigger than
the ground. I was the only ICman.
Oh, okay.
I was the only ICman on board. And on there I went to one school. It was a school for Mark 23, 24. Mark 20, I can't remember what mark it was now of Compass. I went to school for that.
Okay.
And I was the only one of the division. There's 5 monsters. I was the only one. That was my MOS, is that what you call them in the Army?
Right, military occupation specialty.
Yeah, that's what mine ever was at the time. And I was the only one out of all of them. But we had good crews on here. And the other, I'll put it this, every place in the Navy, except the last one, my last station, I really enjoyed myself. And we had good people, good crews, and I learned a lot each place I went. And I spent 28 months on the Fortify, and we made the Westpac trip. We were going down to Thailand and the Philippines, Hong Kong, all the typical places. Oh, just about got one of the highlights when I was under Brown, was we was going from the Philippines up to Japan, and when they made a little jig around, and we went by Iwo Jima.
Oh boy.
And we couldn't see it real plainly, but it was impressive to me. Having been a teenager during the Second World War and all.
And that was just barely 10 years on from the time that happened, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That 10 years hadn't even gone by.
Yeah.
I can imagine what that would have been like.
The minesweeper was the hardest working ship that I was on. We was out in a minefield. It was all practice. Mm-hmm. It was a minefield. And we kept tearing up the gear and bring it in. And they had me helping, the minesweeper electrician, because the magnetic tail is about that big around.
Mm-hmm.
You would put out a signal. One way of a magnetic field, one way, and then the other way, and changed up and down all this to take care of magnetic mines.
Mm-hmm.
And it would hit other gear and it poke a hole in it. So we'd come in, we'd have to splice that all together and wrap it up. And we was in there one time, went in at 6 o'clock in the morning, something like that. And that night, we got aground in the minesweep generator. So we had to take care of that, get that out. We got to bed about 2 in the morning, got up at 6. I got to bed again 52 hours later.
Oh.
And that proved right there that that kind of military is for the young people.
I bet.
And then we got 8 hours of sleep and got up for another 12-hour shift. It was like that a lot on the minesweep. But I did enjoy it.
Oh yeah.
Now most people don't realize how many different kinds of mines like that there are. Like I was telling you one time, you hear about these guys going out and finding these mines, the army guys.
Mm-hmm.
I thought, boy, that's dangerous. Now you get to thinking, well, hell, that's what we did. We was out looking for mines and blowing them up.
And your mines out there were a little bigger than the ones we look for in the dirt.
Oh, yes.
What kind of mines did you encounter? I mean, did you actually get to encounter any during your Westpac trip?
Not live ones.
Mm-hmm.
We made a trip to Thailand, and they wanted us to stay. And in the Gulf of Siam, they wanted us to go over to this World War II field and sweep there so we could raise. But the Navy said, no, they got to go on over to here. Up to the Philippines, then go up to someplace else. And we was on one operation that was over there, and that was in the Philippines. It was in Manila Bay, and it was off Corregidor.
Mm-hmm.
And I forget if it was a Navy or Air Force, they land minefield, but a whole bunch of mines had dropped out of the planes. Just practice mines.
Okay.
They were landing on the beach.
Oops.
We thought, see some guys up there where they can see everything and they're dropping them on the ground instead of in the water.
One of the guests just walked in would like to speak with you.
Okay.
I'll handle the interview. Where are we at? Which war are we fighting right now?
We're just the Cold War now.
Just the Cold War on a minesweeper.
You haven't got him on subs yet.
No, you get it.
Okay.
That's when it's good.
That's when it's crazy, yeah.
Alright, so he's still.
But he is crazy as a kid.
Okay.
We did backtrack and we covered some National Guard because he started out in the Guard real early.
Did we talk about his first date with his wife?
No, we
that's
need
not
to hear about
that's
that.
Not particularly military interest, but it's certainly personal interest. Yeah, how did you? So we got to tell you about how you were introduced in your first date with D. You've told me that story before. I think it's important that it be preserved for posterity's sake.
Well, it was a time after I got out, right after my first hitch.
Mm-hmm.
And in Worland, small town, and I went to a movie one night. And after the movie, I said, well, I'll go across here to the Cheerio Lounge. And I walked in there, and there's a bunch of nurses in there. And I knew some of them from high school. So I danced with them. That's the days when I danced, because I had to. And I danced some of them. There's one gal with them, I didn't know her. She knew me from high school, but she was a freshman when I was a senior in high school there in Worland. And I danced with her, and I made a date with her. She said, okay, yeah, sure. Well, she asked the other girl about me. And they knew me. They gave a good report.
So they lied, basically.
Yeah, basically. That's what she thought. I got that day with her going to the movie. And the other guy, these two buddies of mine, says, let's go with the mop to the movie. I said, no, I got a date. Oh, come on, go. I said, no. Well, they talked me into going to the mop on the date. And then, a couple nights later, I was in the Cheerio Lounge, and this guy walked up, and it was her. And she says, where was you that night? And I said, went to the mops to the movie. He says, you know we had a date. I said, yeah, I know that, but I went to the mops to the movie. No big deal, basically. And this guy I was with says, well, Bill, introduce me to your girlfriend. I'd forgotten her name.
Oh, gosh.
that upset her. But we got married. We've been married for 59 years. Yeah, 59 years.
Wow.
Almost 60. But she still kind of grimaces over that. At least that happened before we got married. We could have got married and said, what the hell's your name again?
All right, so you did a tour of duty on the minesweepers.
Yeah.
And when did you end up on subs and decide that you wanted to to do, you know, duty on subs? What was that a deliberate decision? You had to volunteer for subs, right?
Yeah. After I left the Fortify, I went to Naval Air Station, Whidbey Island, Washington.
Okay.
And up there, they made me master at arms in the mess hall because I was a general service rating. They didn't know what to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
They was going to put me in the film library, the movie library they had up there. But the guy that had the job wouldn't give it up. So they put me in the mess hall as a master at arms, which turned out to be pretty good. I had a lot of time off, but I had no money.
Mm.
We was living quite skimpy then.
Yeah.
We was making, but unlike today, we was making little money. We put $25 a month in the bank, pay our rent, which was only $25, making a car payment.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd go, our entertainment was go bowling once a week. We got by that, okay. But one day when I was up there, I was reading this, what the heck do you call them? But anyway, it said there's a lot of people that joined it.
Oh, the, like the Navy Times?
Just to go to, to go to mines, mm-hmm. to go to submarine school, get submarines. Because the nuke submarines were just coming out then, so they running short of people because they needed people for that.
Mm-hmm.
So I put in for it. I went home and I told Dean, I said, I put in for submarines today. She says, no, no. I said, why not? I said, it's too dangerous. I said, you think minesweepers aren't dangerous? She said, well, yeah. So I went to submarine school.
So you got extra pay for being on subs?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Well, now they get much more than we did. Much, much more.
Sure.
But I got to get pay raise by going there.
Mm-hmm.
I went to sub school at Groton, Connecticut. Some people say New London, but it's not New London. I was stationed there 3 years later on.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Groton, not New London. So
right.
And I went to that school there, and I forget how long it was now. My first submarine after I got out of sub school was the USS Cayman, USS 323. And we got down to San Diego, and I was making about, let's see, C-pay, sub-pay, which was pretty good money at the time.
Uh-huh.
And a pretty good raise when I was making at Whidbey Island.
Yeah.
Because at Whidbey Island, since I worked in the mess hall, when I got my paycheck, half of that had to go back to the Navy because they assumed that I was eating my lunch, my meals in the mess hall.
Right.
And I was. But the submarine Navy is completely different. And it's completely different now than what it was then. But on the Cayman, they give you a qualification book.